Hi, my name's Jerry Cresswell, and pancreatic cancer saved my life. Hello, hi, folks. This is Jerry Cresswell. I'm sitting here with my niece Brina Wagner, and we're going to discuss a little bit about our faith and how pancreatic cancer saved my life. I was brought up here in Shakeyville, you know that.
Mm-hmm.
And your grandpa was a great guy, and grandma, and we had a general store right up the street. And I didn't realize at the time, but mom and dad took care of this community. I mean, they, Pappy worked an overnight job at night shift, and mom opened that store from 7 in the morning till 9 at night. Couldn't ask for a better family. I just tell you right now, it's been wonderful to be in a family like that. When you're growing up, you don't realize, I think, you see other families and you see other people and what they do and how they are, and sometimes you think, man, maybe that would be better for me, but I couldn't beat what I had as a child. It was just tremendously great. And people come back in those days, you didn't have credit cards and stuff like at your store.
Mm-hmm.
They just wrote down all the groceries on the list and people signed their name. And I know through the wintertime, those people laid off, they got very little of their money back on that. So I think, I don't know how they survived it, because they just took care of the whole community.
Mm-hmm.
People come in many nights and not have any money. Someone would want to barter something instead of money. You might give them a gun, you might not have any money. So that's kind of the way it went as we was growing up. And of course, you know, I got growing up, mother always sent us to Bible school in the summertime, and same as you kids.
Mm-hmm.
And then we went to Sunday school, and then we went to church and then youth fellowship.
Mm-hmm.
And when I turned 18, I was drafted in the Marine Corps, and that was quite an experience. I don't talk much about Vietnam, because that's a kind of a hard subject to talk about.
Mm-hmm.
But you grew up in the store up there, right?
Yeah.
Pretty much.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
When did your dad and mom take that over?
Oh, wow. I was young. I can remember opening the store with him before I went to school.
Yeah.
And
same thing.
Kindergarten, I can remember waiting for the bus up there. So
yeah.
Since the time I was little.
Waiting on people, stocking shelves, and pumping
gas. It was my life. Yeah.
Work, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And of course, then your dad had that bad terrific accident, which was.
Yes.
Which was devastating to everybody. And that's one thing I'd like to bring up in the beat of a heart or a snap of a finger, your whole life can change drastically. And it could be anybody, the boys here that are taping us, it could be me or you.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I know your life changed so much, it's unbelievable, with your dad being in that wheelchair for, what, 23 years now?
Yeah, in seventh grade.
Yeah, seventh grade on, yeah. And you got, what, older brother and
two younger sisters.
And everybody's done well. Your sisters, two of them, graduated from college.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a wonderful thing. And your mom's been working day and night. I don't know how she does it, but she does it. When I got back from Vietnam, I was still going to church a little bit down here, to Presbyterian church. And I kind of got away from it. And I got into businesses. I had a real estate insurance business here in Shakeyville. And I got away from church and away from God quite a bit. I just thought I could do everything myself, pretty much.
And mm-hmm.
There's nothing religious about it. I mean, I just kind of mm-hmm. went my way and kind of fell off that track. And then I think July last year, I come up for my granddaughter's wedding,
mm-hmm.
Brittany.
Yep.
And I was sick for 2 weeks while I was up here. And what had happened was I got back to Florida, flew back to Florida, and drove home from Orlando and to Melbourne, and the next morning I was so sick I couldn't make it hardly to the doctor's office.
Mm-hmm.
They diagnosed me with originally with kidney failure. I had a blood disorder. My liver was out of whack, and so they did enough scans on me, checks on me, they found pancreatic cancer, spot on my pancreas. And the diagnosis was
to me, I didn't think much about it. I was that's how far gone I was. I kind of expected it with Pappy having cancer, and then Floyd died with cancer, and Bob died with cancer. It didn't affect me like some people. I just kind of said okay and went on with it. But a little later on, 3 or 4 weeks later, they told me that pancreatic cancer, there's no chance of living with it. I mean, you got 2 to 6 months to live, and I've outlived that range so far. And they told me again a couple weeks ago that I had another. They said maybe another month to 2 months, and I'd be gone. But that's been 5 or 6 weeks ago, so I'm still here. Mm-hmm. And I put all my faith in God and turned over to God, because I don't take chemo anymore. I gave that up because that's the chemo is not doing me any good anymore. I try and get up every day as if I'm well. I tell myself I'm well. I tell myself I'm healed, because Jesus said, by his stripes we are healed, and I believe that. And so I get up every day, get dressed. I try and go out when I can, get out, talk to people, do things. Some days it's very difficult, and all you can do is just lay there. It's kind of like, if you can imagine having a flu for 3 or 4 days, have it for every day of your life for 9 months, and sometimes it's mild, sometimes it's really hard on you, and other times it's almost unbearable. But it's something that is bearable, and something I've been able to get through. And it's only through God. I give God all the glory for that, because the doctors give me no chance, and I've got a great doctor. He's Dr. Neil over here at Mima Health Care Center. He's a good Christian man, and he told me, I got to tell you one time, you ain't got much chance. And I asked him if he believed in miracles, and he said, I've seen miracles. And I pray for him and that staff and all the doctors there and all the nurses. And I couldn't ask for better treatment or better people to be working with me and giving me hope. And it's just been more peace in my life than I've had even when I was well. I was always doing something, going 100 miles an hour, and always had something on my mind. Right now I'm at peace with myself. Peace with God, and I know that if he takes me tomorrow, I'll know where I'm going to be, and I know that he must have a better purpose, a little more purpose for me to stay here, because I've got some things planned, and I plan ahead a little bit, so I make sure I'm going to be here.
You were diagnosed with cancer also. Mm-hmm. Yours was what?
Mine was oral cancer. I had 3 surgeries to my tongue, so.
Okay, and you're all free of cancer now?
We're good. We're good.
That's good. Praise the Lord for that, right?
Amen.
Yeah. I don't know what you took for your cancer.
The type of cancer I had, squamous cell carcinoma to the tongue. If I had had radiation or chemo, they know a lot about cancer now that they didn't know before. If I had had any of those types of treatments, it would have caused it to spread. So my treatment was surgery only. The doctor's prognosis for me wasn't good, in the fact that they said down the road it would spread to my throat, and that's when they would pull out the what they call the ACE card and use chemo and radiation then. They said it would continue to come back. I had 3 surgeries in 2 years for it.
And your faith helped you?
My faith did help me. Going into the 3rd surgery, the 2nd one was very painful. I'm not going to lie. I actually told my husband it was so far back of my tongue that they used a stretcher during the surgery, and I still have a lot of scar damage down into my throat. I begged, I did not want to eat. It hurt. I begged them to just let me go. I wanted to die. I wanted to go to heaven. I didn't want to feel pain anymore. That, and I was in so much pain that I didn't know what I was saying. So my kids were hearing that. So the 3rd surgery, they sent me to Cleveland Clinic, and that's the doctor who's a specialist in my type of cancer that I had, and he's the one that said it would continue to come back, but we prayed that it wouldn't. My pastor and my mom and different ones came before the surgery that time and prayed with me. A key verse for me is Philippians 4:13, because after those surgeries, after the first one, you know what you're getting into. You're not naive anymore, just like you with chemo, you know. So you know what's going to happen. So I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me is what made, you know, helped me get in there. And I would just say it over and over and over again. But the 3rd surgery, the surgeon came out and he said he'd never seen anything like it. When he cut out the biopsy that time, it shriveled up after he cut it up, and he came out and told my husband and my mom that, and we knew it was answered prayer. We're hanging on to that. We believe that that was our miracle, or that was our answer to prayer, and we believe that it's not going to spread like the doctor said.
And I believe that with all my
yes.
heart.
Yes, and it's been 4 years now, so.
Well, I went through the chemo, you know mm-hmm. that. You were with me when I took the first chemo.
Yep.
And they mm-hmm. put me through 8 hours, I think, that day of fluids and chemo. I don't know how they put that much fluid in one body, but they put like 4 liters of fluids in that was mm-hmm. pre-meds. And then they put in a couple bags of chemo, and then they put another pre-med bag in. And then they put a bag with a pump on me and sent me home to have the chemo pumping into my system for another day and a half. So it's like 3 days of chemo. And it just, I mean, I could walk from here to maybe 10 feet and I'd be hanging over the sink because that's how much the energy took on me. Thank God, we prayed about that chemo to make it not so bad on me, and I never got sick with the chemo. I got weak, but never got sick. I didn't do all the things that they say. Some people actually go right from the chemo, right to the hospital. That's how bad it is, so they can mm-hmm. recover in the hospital for that week or week and a half. You know, it took me about that week or so to recover to the point where I'd get enough strength I could go do things, but it was a pretty trying time, and I went through 8 sessions of that. Mm-hmm. And now they're telling me that the chemo is the strongest I could get. I mean, that's the most radical chemo that they could give me. And they're telling me that's not doing me any good anymore. So they're telling me that it spread a little bit to my stomach, to my liver. I don't feel any different. I pray every day about it. I don't pray to heal me anymore. I just pray for thank God for healing me. And I know about 2 weeks into this, it finally hit me how bad it really was. And I renewed my faith with God. I get a little emotional.
Mm-hmm. That's perfectly understandable.
I just thought, well, I'm going to die, and I might as well face the facts that I'm going to be gone. And so I called my brother in Pennsylvania, and I told him to go up to the cemetery and try and get me a couple lots up there where my father and mother are resting now, my brother. And he said okay, and a couple days later I was, believe it or not, I was sitting in my bed and my sister sent me some books and so on, and I'm watching a pastor on television, and as I'm watching him preach, he was at the end of it, and he said, put your hand up to the screen, I'm going to pray for you. And there could be somebody in their bedrooms, there could be in their living rooms, they could be watching on the internet, they could be watching most from anywhere, or listening on a radio. He said, put your hand to the screen, I want to pray for you, and I did. And as he was praying, I fell down on the floor. I buried my face in the wooden floor and I started crying. I started confessing this. I mean, the tears were flowing, and I was confessing everything I've ever done, and I couldn't remember all, but there's so much of it. And I was begging God to forgive me. And after, after about an hour, excuse me for being so emotional, after about an hour, I got myself together and I cleaned up the mess on the floor because it was all wet. I went and took a shower. And when I got in the shower, it started all over again. Started confessing and crying, and I guess I just wanted that water. I wanted that water to wash me clean. And so anyway, I started reading the Bible, I started watching more. I found this wonderful church here with the pastor. I've been coming here every Sunday. I've been wanting to do good. I want to do the Lord's work, and I prayed that. I prayed to give me time, Father, to let me do your good work. And
granted me that. I've been here 9 or 10 months now, and the doctor's report was 2 to 6 months if you're lucky. And I guess I've been pretty lucky. I've been here 9 or 10 months and still feeling pretty good. I get bad reports and I kind of throw them in the garbage or put them in my back pocket. God said all men are liars and his word is the truth, so I stand on his word. I told the pastor one day that this cancer saved my life, and it really has. If I would have been killed in a car accident, heart attack, a lot of people do that. I don't know what happens to you when that happens. I don't know whether, if you instantly die, whether God's right there and you're not saved and you can be seeing all the pits and all that fire and brimstone. If you can say, oh God, forgive me now, I don't know if he's going to come and say, I created you, son, and yes, you're saved, and come with me, or he's going to say, I don't recognize your face, go from me. And I don't want to take that chance, never did. I've always believed in God, I've always prayed. He's answered many of my prayers, and I was too dumb to follow through with it. When he'd answer a prayer, I'd still go out the next day and still be same old Jerry. And I know that when you have a change of heart, you change. People know you change. People know you're saved. Simply by your actions, you really want to help. You want to do things for God. You want to do things for other people. You want to help poor people. You have empathy for the people. You just have a love for everybody and hold no grudges against anybody. Anybody's ever done anything to me or hurt me, I've completely put that in the past and forgiven for it. And I ask people that I might have hurt somehow to forgive me if they can.
But anyway, I renewed my faith. I renewed my faith in God, and I fell on my face and I cried. Mm-hmm.
I know mine caused a renewal too. You know, I think when times are easy, and I've heard other people say that when times are easy, our focus isn't always there.
Yeah.
And
that's when we get away from God, when times get hard, because we don't trust him anymore.
Yeah.
But, I did. I confessed for an hour my sins. I had a puddle of water on the floor.
Mm-hmm.
And confessed my sins, and I... And what did you do?
Same thing. I renewed my faith too. I wasn't away from, I mean, when I was going through mine, I was very actively in the church, so it wasn't that I wasn't walking a Christian walk, but I think there's a faith there that became stronger. So I feel like my faith was renewed. Some people can get angry with God going through things like this.
Yeah.
And it pushes them away, where...
See, I never did.
I got close to God, and I believe you have too.
Yeah.
I know you have. So it, I look at it as a ministry for me. I'm able to talk to people at the store. I never chewed. I mean, I'm a woman. I never chewed a day in my life, but I can talk to men at my business.
That's like me. I go to a store. I go to a supermarket. Wherever I go, I can talk about this now.
Mm-hmm.
And tell people that there's a better way.
Right. Yeah, there is a better way.
And, you know, there's some things that will never be healed by doctors.
Mm-hmm.
But this is a natural healing.
Mm-hmm.
that only God can give you. And
mm-hmm.
Jesus died on the cross for that. And every day I go over the resurrection in my mind.
Mm-hmm.
It's been a blessing to me, because I really feel like I could have been killed in an auto accident.
Mm-hmm.
Could have been, had a heart attack at my age. Been gone straight to hell.
Mm-hmm.
Because of the life I was leading. And I think now that I've had months and months, I mean, I'm not supposed to be here now, but
yeah.
I think it may be all this is meant to be. And I don't think, I believe God could reach down and heal me right this second, and I'd be perfectly clean.
Mm-hmm.
I also believe that if he did that, I'd probably be a backslider. If he would have done that immediately when I first got cancer, he would have said, hey, you know, I would have said, hey, thank you, God, and he would have healed me. I might not have appreciated it as much as I am right now, the time I have and so on.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's a lot there's a lot to how you heal,
mm-hmm.
and the amount of time it takes, and the amount of time it gives you to testify
mm-hmm.
for God and for Jesus Christ. So
mm-hmm.
I don't know what else to tell anybody, but I can tell you this: you need to get yourself with a faith-based church
mm-hmm.
if you can. One that to preach the Bible,
mm-hmm.
not just their own theories,
mm-hmm.
and believe in that Bible and believe in Jesus Christ. Get yourself going to church so that you'll be with people at least, you know, an hour out of the week is not too much. We spend very little time.
We do.
People don't realize how much time we spend watching TV, how much mm-hmm. time we do with sports, playing computer games,
mm-hmm.
and the Bible lays there and we don't read it. You need to read the Bible. You need to understand what Jesus did for you. And once you do that,
yeah.
you're going to go to heaven if you never did any good works. And then what you need to do is start doing the good works and tithing. Tithing's all a big part of this. And I know a lot of people say that I don't want to tithe because I can't pay my bills. You need to pay that 10% first. And it will all come back to you. I've proven it with mm-hmm. me.
God will bless you.
Mm-hmm. You'll get God's blessings if you just get with the program and, mm-hmm. and do what you should be doing. So I don't know. I'm not going to give you my phone number. I'd be glad to give you Brandon's if you want to call in and ask any questions.
Oh, you're funny. I love you.
I love you too, baby.
That the Lord of all the earth would care to know my name, would care to feel my hurt. Who am I that the bright and morning star would choose to light the way for my ever wandering heart? Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling. Lord, you catch me when I'm falling, and you've told me who I am. I am yours. I am yours. Who am I that the eyes that see my sin would look on me love and watch me rise again? Who am I that the voice that calmed the sea would call out through the rain and calm the storm?
Saturday, May 18th. I think it starts the Friday.
This
Saturday
gonna,
and Sunday.
This is going to be, it's going to be called a change of life weekend.
Mm-hmm.
And it's going to be a revival type setting. On Friday night there's going to be a service.
Mm-hmm.
Saturday there's going to be for children and teenagers. I believe there's going to be a Christian puppeteer there.
Yeah.
And there's going to be pizza and there's going to be music and there's mm-hmm. going to be it's going to be neat. And it's going to be neat for the teenagers and the kids, obviously. And then Sunday we're going to have it's going to be what a dinner. There's going to be a dinner for a little girl, a six-year-old girl in the community, because she's got a disease, and we're going to go ahead and collect money, take money for that. Now, this is all, there's no money being spent on this. It's all donations, so
mm-hmm.
so it's all, it's wonderful. People are donating the pizzas, they're donating money, they're donating their time.
Yep.
So there's no expense to this, out-of-pocket expense, except for getting there, getting the gas there, and getting to the place, and everybody's invited, including the Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
And You know the name of some of the groups that are going to be there? Because I know that, that people follow these groups around.
I know the band Shutter's going to be there.
Shutter's going to be there. And they have a following from the area.
Mm-hmm.
Barbie Snyder and some of the guys. I don't know the name of the group.
Yeah, what's the name of their group? Skinny Brothers or something.
Skinny Brothers.
Yeah.
Skinny Brothers. Probably get to see them because
they're Sunday, I believe.
They're going to be a good group to see. They're pretty awesome. So this is going to be nice. There's going to be a lot of fellowship there. We're hoping to have a lot of people. If we only get one person and he finds God, that'd be a wonderful thing. But we're planning on having a lot of people. We've got some ministers coming in to give messages. We're going to have altar calls. We're gonna make a thing happen so that people are going to enjoy it, and maybe we can do it more often and help build the community up. And I think it's going to be a good thing.
It will be a good thing.
Hear me when I'm calling. Lord, you catch me.